Welcome friends to this holiday party today. When I get a little late like I am today, I tell a story. These great stores like Walmart and Walgreens and some other big grocery stores that are here, they are hiring recently retired people as greeters. So these retired people, they just want to work. They don't care about the salary. They have got big pensions and so on. But they like to be involved in something. So that is why they accept these jobs as greeters. There was one greeter who was hired by Walmart. And he was very nice. He greeted people so nicely, the sales went up. More people would love to go to that particular Walmart. But he would come 10 minutes, 15 minutes late every day. The manager said, "My friend, you are coming late. You are such a good person. Everybody respects you. They like you. But you come late every day. What would your people say in your office when you came late like this at your previous job?" And he put his head down. He said, "They would say, 'Good morning, Admiral. May I bring your coffee?'" That's a good story to get forgiveness for being late. I am very happy that I can spend this time with you. This is a friendship that we have. When I see you individually or collectively, it's a strange feeling that I have known you for a long time, that we are old friends. Even people coming to me for the first time in this physical life look like we have known each other earlier. I don't know where this feeling comes from. But it establishes a kind of relationship that's very difficult to find normally in the world. A kind of friendship that seems to be set up long ago and will last forever. It's not the kind of casual acquaintance we have with people. So that is why sometimes one gets a feeling that these relationships we have are not born out of our context in this life. They may be from previous lives. We recirculate again and again because the karmic pattern is such that we have to meet the same people again and again. We don't have karma with some people and then we come pay off with other people. The law of karma says that we have to settle the accounts with the same people. By the way, the karma is created by the human mind. It is not created by nature. It's not created by animals and birds and so on. It is created by the human mind. When the human mind intends to do something, it creates a karma. If it actually does that, it enhances the effect of that karma. But the law of karma says that the only form of life in which karma can be created is the human form. And it is created at the level of the mind, not at the level of the action of the body. Some people think that it is the action that creates karma. That is not true. You can have many actions, unintentional, not knowing, and not in conscious awareness. So many actions we do of which we are not even aware of, or they are so accidental that we have no intention. How can that be creating a karma to pay off? That is why the law of karma says that only when we intend to do something, karma is created, whether we do it or not. But if the action is carried out, the impact of that karma for repayment is enhanced. That is what the law of karma says. Karma is created by the mind and paid off by the mind. It's not paid off by the body or by the sense perceptions or by anything else. It's created in the mind and paid off by the mind. If the mind feels happy, you got a good result from your good karma. And if your mind is sad and in pain, then you are paying off a bad karma. What determines what is good and bad karma is also our own mind. The mind determines what is good and bad, and that is based upon where we are born, who our parents are, what our society is in which we live, what country we live in, what culture we are born in, All these things, all the situations created for us by our birth at a particular place determine what our moral code is, what our moral values are, what we think is good, what is bad. Once the mind accepts what is good and bad, it follows that. And therefore, a lot depends on where you are born, what your culture is, what your people believe in. Very often you will find that what is good in one country is not good in another country, what is bad in one country not bad in another country. Not only that, what was good once, 100 years ago, is bad today, what is bad then is good today. These good and bad changes all the time. So what we call our moral code, there is no set moral code at all. The moral code is set in our own mind, and the mind then follows it and it considers this is good, this is bad, and its own consideration at the time of making an intention generates the kind of karma that we have to pay off. Karma can only be created in the human life. That is why it's called karma juni. That means a life in which karma can be created. All other lives, all other forms of life, all 8.4 million minus 1 are to pay off karma. You can imagine how much capacity we have to create that large amount of karma. It requires millions of lives to pay it off. That is only possible because the karma is not based on action but on intention. Every day we say, I wish I could do that to somebody, karma is created. Now, karma can be paid off in many forms. It can be paid off in plant life. It can be paid off in life of insects and birds and animals and human beings and angels and gods and those who created these universes. All these are means of payment. The old story goes that Lord Krishna, when he was very young, he was with his young friend Udo, and they were in the forest or in the grazing ground, taking the cows out for grazing. And there Krishna says, Arjun, the nature of karma cannot be easily explained. We don't understand what it is. It has such great ramifications that no human being understands it. For example, at that time he saw a little ant crawling on the ground. He said, look Udo, this ant that's crawling here was once Brahma, the creator of this universe. This very ant at one time was Indra, which is the lord of one of the largest heavens in the astral plane. Because of his earlier karma, when that period of his glory ended, he became an ant. He says there is no end to this, that you cannot do something good to overcome a bad karma. If you do something good today, you are rewarded for it. You do something bad today, you are punished for it by your own mind. Rewarded by your mind, punished by your mind. Circumstances are created by which you accept that reward and punishment. That is all that karma is about. But the ramifications of karma are so deep that because we have created intentions in our mind, we are virtually trapping ourselves forever into birth and rebirth. Because we cannot escape from the cycle of birth and rebirth unless we are able to pay off our karma. And the karma keeps on increasing. We sometimes feel the best time to pay off karma might be in the form of a human being. Because we can regret, we can feel sorry, we can have a sense of guilt. Oh, we did bad things, we pay off. Good things we enjoy. But that is not true. The karma is very little paid off in a human life. We don't have enough time. Trees can live for thousands of years. Angels can live for millions of years. Angels can live the whole life of a mind. Gods who create the universes at different levels of consciousness are created for millions of years. Imagine karma being paid off in that form. It can take so long. Human life is very short. That is why what happens in human life, what happens in human life, that it not only gives us the opportunity to create karma, It also gives opportunity to pay off karma, but the time is very short to pay off karma. Therefore, most of our karma is not paid off in one human life, nor in two, nor in ten. If you know how much we put intentions into our head, you can imagine it cannot be paid off in several human lives. Therefore, we are sowing seeds here through our intentions to stay forever, virtually forever. Where does the karma go if we have not paid off in one human life? It goes into a reserve. A reserve that's also in our own mind. Mind has a very long life, millions of lives, 3 to 5 million lives is estimated by some calculators or mystic calculators. They say the mind's life is as much as 3 to 5 million of physical years. So in one mind you can hold on the karma of several lifetimes and keep on paying, keep on getting reward, keep on getting punishment. This, therefore, they divide karma into three parts. One which we have created this life from past karma, which we call pralabdha or destiny. It is our destiny to be born like that. That is our past karma, from which pieces have been taken, not necessarily from one life, from several lives. In our epic stories, where there is a story of a blind king in Krishna's time, and he looks back, he had the ability to look back into his past lives. He looks back life after life, life after life, and he tells Krishna, I have seen 100 of my past lives. I did nothing in any of those lives to be blind. Then why am I blind? And Krishna says, look back further. Your 104th life, that long ago, you took out the eyes of a person, and that is why you are blind today. He said, karma does not go away. Even after 104 lives, the karma can still be come back as part of your life in this physical body. So that is why the destiny we talk of, the pralabdha that we talk of, which generates our destiny and this life from birth to death, with all the ramifications of what will happen, where we will be born, who our parents will be, where we will meet people, who we will meet, where we will have accidents, where we will die. All these events are all pre-planned and become part of our destiny of life and based upon several lifetimes of ours, of the past. So the pralabdha is not merely repaying something that happened in the last life. It can be traced back, way back into past lives. The next part is when we use intention. When do we use intention? The intention is used to create new karma between the events of destiny. Destiny says you'll be here, and then we tend we do that. The difference between an old event that is payoff of karma and a new event that we are creating karma, the difference is that karma, when it's created, has a period of deliberation, of thinking, that gives you a choice to do or not to do. If there is no choice, it's a past karma being paid off. Only the intention to do something is effective to create a new karma if you're given a choice. Therefore, to create a karma, there is a moment of deliberation in the head. A deliberation in which you use what looks like a free will. The free will that we are experiencing has to be used, and a deliberation takes place in our mind. Should I not do this or do that? When that happens, we create a new karma. So that is why the new karma is distinguished from the pralabdha karma or destiny. It's called kareman karma, karma created for the future. So that adds up the karma created by our deliberate action through free will is the new karma. And what is then stored in the mind has been called sinchit karma or reserve karma. The reserve karma is a real problem because that can hold you back here forever. And that is the biggest trap that has been set up, which is keeping us here. Lifetime after lifetime, we are trapped because of that kind of karma. Now I got some good news. the best news for the merry holidays and for the new year, that if one finds or is found by a perfect living master and happens to get initiated by that master, it's time to go back home and one gets initiation, the sinchit karma is totally erased and burnt up at the time of initiation. It's a very big thing. Happy, happy holidays. This is one of the greatest moments, that initiation by a perfect living master erases the sinchit karma completely. But what is left over is the karma generated by this life. That is still there. Because we have, at the time of initiation, also lived through a period of creating karma. That is still pending. Therefore, if any future life is made up, it's made up only of the karma of this current life. Therefore, generally, is much better than a life that would be created merely out of the sinchit karma. So that is why, if we have to have another life, hopefully we should not ask for another life, but some people love it. Some people say, we have enjoyed this adventure, we find out it's not a real thing, and we want to come again, they can come. There can be other reasons also for wanting to come back again. And one of the reasons is that you may be in love with your master to such an extent, you say, if the master is still here, I want to come back again. Actually, I'll tell you a little true story about my own father. My dad was the initiate of great master Baba Sarvat Singh. He did not attend a particular discourse of the great master, in which the great master said, if one is initiated by a perfect living master, there is no possibility for him to get more than four lives in total. The one we are having now at the time of initiation, and three more, at the most. Even if there is a worst of karmas taken place before initiation, it cannot lead to more than three lives. And actually, some saints have even described the progress one makes in four lives. Swamiji of Agra, who set up the Radha Swami faith, he describes the four lives in the following way. I'll translate it for you. Ek janam gur bhakti, janam dusre naam, janam tisre turiyapad, chauthe me nijdham. It is translated, you have four lives for a spiritual journey. The first life is the build-up of love and devotion for your master. The second life is when you get initiated by a master. Third life is when you can reach to the top of the causal plane and discover where creation takes place. In the fourth life, you go to your true home. That's what he describes as his normal pattern. But the normal pattern doesn't mean everybody has to go through it. One can complete all the four things in one life. Or it may be spread out over a longer period, that Naam started or the initiation came after three, four lives of developing love and devotion. So there's no fixed pattern. But when great master in his discourse mentioned that you cannot have more than four lives, in the evening my dad had a chance to meet the great master. He used to meet some people in the evening. And he said, Master, I heard that you said one cannot have more than four lives after initiation. What if I want five? And great master said, Lake Raj, that was my dad's name, Lake Raj, this is your last life. Where are you looking for? Five? He said, I am told sometimes masters come back. And when they come back, the disciples should also be there. I am told you may come again and again. If you come fifth time, don't leave me back in such kind. I want to be here with you. So everybody laughed. Then great master explained that it is not true that you have to come for four lives or five lives or whatever. You should think of it that we have been trapped for so long here, we should go back to our true home in this very life. So that is why great master always insisted that you should not worry that sinchit karma is over. Pay off your karma of this one life within this life and finish off the account. He also said that there are other areas where you can pay off karma. Not create, but pay off. The astral region is also available to us for paying off karma. The causal region is also available. Some people say that some masters have specially emphasized that some karma is held up and you have to pay it off in the astral causal stages, and you cannot go to your true home till they are paid in those stages. Yes, but that is karma only of the single life in which you get initiated. When you get initiated, that period which you already passed, if there is too much burden on this, and great master says, master don't want you to come again. Now I can tell you some interesting story about great master. He was a very clever master, a very clever gentleman. When he was being appointed as a master by his master, Baba Jamal Singh, the story runs and narrated to me by one of the people who was present at that time, old man who was present at the time when Baba Jamal Singh, great master's master, told him that you will be the next master. There were 14 people sitting there. 14 people are sitting, and Baba Jamal Singh is saying, this will be my last day of talking to you. My work is done. My work will now be carried out by you, Sawan Singh, he pointed out to great master. And great master got a little alarmed, and he looked around and he said, master, there are 14 of us sitting here. These people have done more meditation than me. I am an employee in a government job. I don't have the time to meditate so much. So why are you looking at me when there are more advanced satsangis, advanced disciples of yours sitting right around me? And Baba Jamal Singh said, let me check it out, because I check everything out from my own master, that is Swamiji. So he closed his eyes for a while and he opened his eyes. He says, new moj has come. That means a new will has been described by the master, by his master. New moj has come. And my master says, only Sawan Singh will do this work. The great master said, master, I must tell you, I have got a very nice house given to me by the government. And I have a lavish style of living based on my job. You are living in a too little hut. And you want me to leave my big house and come and live in those two huts to carry on your work? Isn't that not fair? He said, let me check it out. So he closed his eyes and opened after a minute and said, new moj has come. My master says when Sawan Singh will do his work, he will live in a house better than the one he's living in now. Did not satisfy my master. Great master said, but master, remember that I will be retiring soon and my pension will be very small. You have been telling people that the next master who will come will have a large crowd of disciples, that thousands of people will come to him. So how will I manage to take care of those people with my meager pension that I will be getting from the government job? And Baba Jamal Singh closed his eyes, and after a minute he says, new moj has come. Swamiji says that when Sawan Singh will be doing that work, he will have to spend nothing from his pension, and people will bring the food and the cash and the money and whatever is needed for the thousands of people who will come, and none will go hungry from him. That should have satisfied great master according to me. But he was more clever than I am. He didn't stop there. He said, and this is the most important thing I'm telling you, he said, master, you have been telling people that if one is initiated by a perfect living master, he cannot be reborn for more than 4 lives. And the master will take care of him, even if he is halfway. Pastor, I am trying to go back to my true home in this very life. You are going to get me stuck with those people who will need four lives? And great master, own master Baba Jamal Singh says, wait a minute. And he closed his eyes. And he opened his eyes. He says, new Moj has come. That whoever is initiated by Baba Sawan Singh will not have to come to a second life. This will be their last life. Very big. Very big. Very big news. And it is unbelievable how that power worked. That great master disciples do not have to come into their second life. Unless they choose to. They can choose to come another life. There can be many reasons for the choice. One of the reasons why some disciples whom I recognize that they were in great master time, initiates of his. And when I talk to them, they say, we feel we were there in the Dera, in our previous birth. We have been born in America now, we are Americans, but we remember. It's feeling, we have a deja vu when we go there or see something, that we were possibly there in a past life. And I get the same feeling when I see those people. Then the thought comes to me that why have they come again when they were not supposed to come? That was their supposed to be their last life. So I had to check up with my own master. So the answer given was very interesting. He said that what Baba Jamal Singh said, they will not have to come, but they can come if they want to. Why are they coming in the United States of America? The reason can be traced back to 1937. In 1937, great master told one of his American disciples, Julian Johnson, he said, you have come here to take spirituality to America. He said the axis of spirituality, which has been in the East and the Middle East for a long time. If you look at the history of the great masters who came, perfectly the masters who came, they were born in the East. They were born in India, China, and those countries, large countries. But the West was trying to make money, to build up fortunes, to build up affluence. The West will build up the affluence to a point that the riches they will make, the money they will make, will neither give them peace nor happiness. Therefore, they will look to something that is coming from the East, the spirituality. Therefore, the axis of spirituality will shift. And the spiritual seeking that has been existing for a long time in the East will shift to the West and localize itself in a big way, Julian Johnson, in your country, United States of America. He said this in 1937. I was a witness to that conversation. In fact, I must tell you, it was that conversation that stuck in my mind, and United States of America looked like a very good destination. As soon as I retired from my job, I said, I have to go to that country, United States of America, and take a ringside seat to see the show that great master is talking about. That's why I'm here. And I'm seeing the show. That really the axis of spirituality is shifting. He also said, great master also said, that whereas the people in America will think that the economic development and development of wealth is the biggest thing, they will change that. The economic rise of the West will decline. The spiritual values will go up. On the other hand, in the East, in countries like India and China, the big countries, they will lose spirituality gradually. And affluence will become their object, like in the West. This whole shift is taking place. You will see. This will take place 50, 60, 100 years. In the next 50, 60, 100 years. This is exactly what I am seeing now. They are all India, China, both countries are so busy trying to make physical wealth. That's the biggest goal for them now. And in this country, every day I find new people coming up, new organizations coming up, so many people getting more and more interested in discovering the ultimate truth. So many have found out this physical world is not our own world. So many new yoga centers are coming up. I got very surprised when I found that there was one gentleman, a comedian in Hollywood, his name was John Roger. And John Roger had never been to India, but in his dreams, he saw a white bearded man. And when he checked it out, he found it was great master Baba Savan Singh. He died a few years ago. In October of 2014, he passed away. He was considered a master by his followers. Most of his followers are in Hollywood, actors or producers of movies, comedians. He himself was a comedian. And he became a master teaching the principles of great master's teachings without ever having met him. Because he said every time he finds that he gets the messages inside from the same white bearded man. In his bedroom, where he passed away, only two photographs are there, both of great master Baba Savan Singh, whom he had never met. How is it possible? How is he doing this work? Another strange thing happened. How do I know about it? Because in October of 2014, he passed away. In October of 2015, a lady who was working with him for 40 years, she was on the typewriter preparing, on the computer, she was preparing a speech for their annual commemoration of his passing away, something that they were going to read at the meeting of their followers. And they had set up a society or a mission called MSIA, Movement for Spiritual Inner Awareness. It looks very similar to Institute for Study of Human Awareness that my friend Jonathan is heading. So when this MSIA was set up and they were preparing a speech, she was typing accidentally, she called it accident. By accident, a photo appears of somebody they don't know. And she says, accident, another photo coming in the middle of the typing. When they see under the photo, they see my name, disciple of great master Baba Savan Singh. She jumped up and said, J.R. has sent us this message. They used to call John Roger J.R. Then J.R. has sent the message. We should trace where he is. And they contacted me. And they wanted to come to Chicago to make a video of an interview with me, whether I was saying the same things that great master was saying, something like that. And I had a plan to go to California, to Los Angeles area anyway. So I told them, why do you want to come to Chicago? I am coming there. So I went there. I met those disciples of J.R. And I was surprised. I was interviewed by one of the actresses who had acted long ago, was a prize winner or something. And she, there was an interview, it's all available on YouTube also. But I was surprised how great master's message is working out somewhere. I had no knowledge at all. Then I found this is just one story. A lot of people from that organization are now meeting me almost on every program in all over the country. So it appears that what I am trying to do as seva for my master seems to be connected with the master saying that things will move here, and some people definitely have, just for that reason, come back to watch the show. Like I came to this country to sit on the ringside seat, they've also come for the same purpose. That was allowed. There was no bar on coming again. So that could be possible. Another gentleman also has a ministry of light and sound. And he had a vision, and there were two people running that ministry. He had a vision. He was meditating for all his life. But he had a vision, a face appeared in his meditation, deep meditation, came very close to him and said, "I know who you are." And then the face disappeared. He didn't know who it was. But after a few days, somebody told him, "Have you heard of Ishwar Puri on YouTube? There are talks." He said, "I've never heard of him." So when they showed him the picture, this was the guy who came. And why did he ask me this? So he contacted us, Jonathan, that I want to know from this guy, why did he say this? Now Jonathan told me, there's a guy who had this experience and he is going to ask you, why you came? I never went anywhere, I must tell you. And why he says this, supposing he comes to me tomorrow, he might come tomorrow and ask me, why did you say, I know who you are? What will I say? Should I pretend I really know? I should tell him, sorry friend, this is your own delusion, your own hallucination, I don't know. I am only mentioning these new developments taking place, which are showing that the prophecy of the great master Baba Sawan Singh is being implemented, is coming through, and is actually happening in the United States of America in a big way, West generally. It can go into South America, it will be in some parts of Europe. But what was in the East, Far East, is coming here. That's good news for all of us who are living here. It's a good news that we have these opportunities which we didn't have. We thought the only thing to do in life was to make some greenbacks. I was told that the greenback is very important here. I didn't know, maybe there are people from another culture who have greenbacks or something. Till I found that the currency notes here, the dollar bills here, all have a greenback. And they, it's a very interesting thing, that the greenback, the dollar bill, why did they pick up green? There's a G for green, G for God. I don't know if it is true. But the greenback, when I saw the greenback first time, the dollar bill, I was amazed. Because on the dollar bill of the United States, there is a picture of a pyramid. I don't know if you noticed, there's a pyramid on a dollar bill, and in the top of the pyramid is a single eye. A single eye, like what Jesus Christ spoke of. If thy eye be single, thy whole body shall be filled with light. I said, this is a great spiritual country. This is truly the greenback. But the front of the greenback is very interesting. I studied that dollar bill so carefully. I said, this country is destined to be a great spiritual country. If their whole currency, which is their God, which they worship, it contains this message itself. The message of a pyramid, the message of a single eye is right on their currency. It impressed me a lot. But I also noticed that at the stage when I came, which was in the 60s, the first time I visited here, at that time, the greenback was considered to be like God. People worshipped it. So I went to the bank. And I said, give me some crispy notes, crispy bills. And I put them in my wallet, $100 bills. I was not making much money, but whatever I had, I put them as $100 bills. We would go to have a cup of coffee, I produce $100 bill. Everybody said, he's an enlightened person. I'm telling you the truth. I know a poor cobbler has no chance of being a master here. A poor weaver has no chance. I'm glad Kabir and Ravidas went away in India. Here, the enlightenment means I can produce $100 bills. They would look at my bills before I paid. Crispy new. Do you know what they said? They are manufactured in my wallet. These are true stories. I did some business with a couple of friends here, two black boys, and they actually believed that the bills are being produced from my wallet. And one of them said to me, I want you to produce two bills with the same number. I said, these are currency notes, these are currency bills from a mint produced by the printing presses of the government. I don't print them. No, you can't keep on producing them like that. I said, this is such an easy way to be enlightened in this country. Have some fresh $100 bills, and you want to pay a bill of $4 or $5, produce $100, and you are enlightened. Of course, now people have really become more enlightened, and they know the bills do not create spirituality. The bills do not create any enlightenment. The bills tie us down more here. These currency bills are not helping us to go inwards, they're helping us to stay outwards. So that is why the importance of the currency bills will go down. The importance of finding the real single eye. What is single eye? Why did they make the picture of a single eye on that $1 bill? If you haven't seen it carefully, please look at the $1 bill and see how beautifully they made on top of the pyramid. The single eye is merely a description of where we actually see with these two eyes. It's a very interesting feature. The two eyes in the physical body cannot see the same thing. They see two images. There is no way that they can see the same thing. They are separated. And you can easily close one eye and put a finger in front of you, you see finger at one place, open the other finger in a weaker form and move to another place. We are seeing two and making them one. Where are we making them one? In the physical body. I'm not talking of spiritual, a inner third eye center or something. I am talking simply of the two physical eyes. Where are we combining the two images? Of course, in 3D movies, they help us to combine by giving us special glasses. Either two colored glasses, they used to be green and red, and the picture, the movie was drawn up in green and red, and two pictures were on the screen, which the two eyes would see, and because they were separate, the eyes could combine them and look like three-dimensional distance. These eyes, without those glasses, is combining two images. Where are they combining? Can't be outside. They are seeing inside. In these eyes. Can't be anywhere in front. It has to be inside. There are no glasses. When you study this carefully, that if we are seeing with two eyes, where are we combining to make it one image? You will find it is exactly behind the eyes, in the center, at the very point which we have been calling third eye center. Location can be very specifically indicated behind these eyes, between the ears, in the center. Check it out for yourself. Therefore, we are operating even now physically from the third eye center. There's no other place to be looking in that world. We have two ears. Why not one? We could have had one eye and one ear, it would have been very different. This reminds me of a joke. Shall I tell you a story? Sometimes we make stories of people who come from Punjab. You know, Punjab is the state from where I came. Our culture is very different there. We call our culture agriculture. You know? So that is why when the Punjabis come here and look for jobs, they have a little difficulty. I also had a little difficulty to get a green card or to get a job. Now, I was talking of the eyes and ears. That is just a way of saying that the basis for our experiences, the basis why we create distance, which we see as distance, is built into our eyes. Why we see direction built into our ears. It's a normal function of the human function of these organs. These are much deeper than the inner eyes and inner ears. They also function very similarly. They also create distance and also directions. But what I was going to tell you was that three gentlemen, I won't give you their names, I'll call them ABC. They came, they were detectives in the police department of Punjab government. And they decided to immigrate and come to United States and join the Federal Bureau of Investigation, FBI. An inspector of the FBI interviewed them. The first guy, Mr. A, comes in and the inspector says, "You have shown you have a lot of experience of detective work. I am going to test you. On this screen in front of you, a small computer screen, I will flash the picture of an actual suspect we have in custody. I'll show you for 30 seconds. And you tell me, if you see that person, will you be able to identify him and how?" So a picture was flashed for 30 seconds. And the man said, "That is no problem at all, Inspector. I can always find him because this guy has only one eye." He said, "Did you realize it's a profile we are showing you? Get out of here." Then came the second person. Mr. B is interviewed. And he's flashed the same picture and says, "Can you tell?" "Oh, no problem. I can find this man. He has only one ear." He says, "You are seeing the profile from the side of a person. You are not seeing the whole person. Get out of here." Now the clever Mr. C comes. And he says, "I'll show you the same picture I showed others and tell me how you can recognize him." When the picture was flashed, this man says, "I can tell you. This suspect of yours is wearing contact lenses." Now that was a big thing. He said, "Hold on." He checked, "Is the suspect that we have in custody really wearing contact lenses?" Answer was yes. Mr. C was hired. Hired was, but this inspector was surprised in 30 seconds. The man can judge from the side of the eye he's seeing that the person is wearing contact lenses. That's a great ability. I'm amazed how he did it. So after a week or so, he asked Mr. C, "Please tell me genuinely, how did you know that person was wearing contact lenses?" He said, "That was simple. If a person has only one eye and one ear, he can't wear regular glasses." I'm glad we have two eyes and 2 ears. Just a story. This is not from Rishi. Anyway, I'm very happy that I could make you all laugh. It's nice to laugh. They say laughter is the best remedy. There is many ways to laugh. I haven't generally spoken about this subject of laughter too much. But the truth is, if you examine the power of laughter, and I talk about the sense of humor and the 6th, 8th sense, the highest sense, how do we express it? Smiling, laughing. And that is why it is true. Laughter is a very good remedy. It makes you feel happy, takes you out of depression, takes you out of so many negative things. So laughter is a good thing, but there are many kinds of laughter. I don't know if you analyze them. At one time, I tried to analyze. what types of laughter do we have? I discovered that the most common laughter why people laugh is in what they call the vowels in English language. A, I, E, O, this is A, ha 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 ha, like that. Or he he he. Ooh. These are vowel laughter. Very common. The less common one is where you want to laugh, but the laughter cannot come, it's too much in you. An example would be, oh, you can't even get it out. But the most interesting form of laughter is where you cannot know if the person is laughing or crying. I'll give you an example. I'm glad you all laughed. Thank you. Well, perhaps you thought I only knew how to give spiritual talks, which I've learned from that. No, I can also talk about laughter. It's nice to see that when we have a holiday, we laugh. We enjoy our laughter. We laugh inside. We smile inside. People do meditation and I see their faces very serious. It's a very serious matter. When they go on a vacation, they're laughing. Take your meditation as a vacation. Take your meditation non-seriously. It's a vacation. You're going to a better place. We run to beaches and these places to have a good time. And look at the variety of experiences available just by putting your attention within yourself. There's no greater vacation than that. There's no greater joy you can get than to travel inside. There's so much to travel. There's so much vastness. This world looks very vast. We can't even go anywhere. We're confined to one small little planet on which we are so small compared to the planet. And if you see the planet compared to Jupiter and other planets, it's so small. Compared to other star, you can't even see it. It's not even a speck. Somebody sent me a nice video in which they showed the position of our person. We are standing in big land, then we become small, then the land becomes small, then the whole planet becomes small. Then the planet shrinks to size compared to other planets. Then we see our own sun. Our planets are very small compared to sun. Then we see sun is a very small star compared to larger star. When we saw the size of the largest stars, they are so huge. We talk of million times, billion times bigger star than our star existing. And then they are part of galaxies which are even bigger. And for a long time, people have been saying, this universe, this huge universe, which I'm describing, came out of a big bang. About 13.4 billion years ago? It's a short period of time compared to the total time of trillion of years we can think of. That a big bang took place and the whole of the universe was created. They still believe it. I made a prediction about 50 years ago. I said, if they have better telescopes, they will be shocked to see what is there. Because if we are born 13.4 or 13.6 billion years ago, then the whole universe didn't exist. Time and space did not exist. They were generated at that time. I have to fit in this concept with the concept that I learned from spiritual experiences, which say that this is a very long-term recreated universes again and again. There is no end to it. So when I put back this idea that this expanding world, 13.6 billion years ago, something happened called a Big Bang. And this universe began to appear, time and space appeared, and somehow the first conversion of that big energy into matter made that into a hydrogen atom. That was the simplest of atoms in the periodic table. So then the hydrogen atom somehow quickly became multiplied by a metabolic process and became a helium. And then gradually slowed down, and now we have a huge periodic table of so many elements. That's what they believe. The physics professors are telling me this thing. They've been telling me for 50 years. And I said, if that is so, then if we have a telescope that can see a star far away, from where the light takes 1 year to come to us, and that is the nearest star, by the way, it's more than 1 year, light year away. Then when we are seeing the star, we are not seeing the star as it is now, we are seeing the star as it was a year ago. It taken 1 year for us to come, and now we are looking at it, we think it's a star in the sky, and actually it was there a year ago. If the star, say 10 million years ago, we are seeing what was happening 10 million. They acknowledge that. They acknowledge nothing can move faster than velocity of light. It takes 182,000 miles per second for light to come, and therefore a million of light years means that what we are seeing happened million years ago. If you go more, it can be billion years. If you go 13.6 billion years ago, you'll see the Big Bang. Very simple, elementary. So they began to build better telescopes. They have recently reached as far as almost 9 billion light years away and seen what happened 9 billion years away. It should be a much smaller universe, which is expanding. The further we go back in time, it should lead to one singularity where the Big Bang took place. Every time they have a better telescope, the universe is bigger than they ever imagined. So how is that possible? They're trying to say in the beginning, the universe expanded very rapidly, and then it slowed down. Okay, wait for a few years more. You will cross 13.6 billion light years, and you see a much bigger universe existing. This bothered one of our scientists who died recently.
Stephen Hawking,
yeah. Who was paralyzed because of his illness. And he was studying, first of all, the origin of these black holes. How the black holes can absorb everything, including light. Now they say black hole can absorb your time and space. Well, towards the end of his life, when he saw that good telescopes are not showing a smaller world, but a bigger world. Obviously, the Big Bang did not have the same end. He began to talk of a new concept, multiple universes. He died saying there are multiple universes, and maybe the black hole I'm talking of is just a creative power of a universe, which fit him with the concepts we have on the spiritual path. These universes are being created all the time, all over the space and time generated. Now, if you want to understand it from the point of view of deep meditation, if you go into deep meditation and go to the causal plane and see the creation of time and space, there you discover that time and space is being generated at multiple universes simultaneously. The very thing they will discover in physics today, in astronomy today, they'll discover. Imagine how much information you can have, which physics and science is trying to discover today, and they get shocked at every moment when they try to discover something new. They have to revise their physics nowadays. I mentioned that the most weird thing that surprised Einstein, Albert Einstein was surprised when they found that particles get entangled. And if two entangled particles are separated, they don't follow his principle that nothing can travel faster than the velocity of light. Because you do anything to one particle, instantly it happened to the other particle. It takes no time at all for the message to transfer. We have to break even that law that you were talking of. Only a few days ago, they were able to do something they never expected. They're breaking another law of physics. That when they transfer heat, when heat is transferred from one object to another, it needs particle of matter, a molecule or something, or an electromagnetic range existing. When heat comes from the sun to us, it travels through an electromagnetic layers existing. That is why heat can come. If there's total vacuum, with nothing in it, not an electromagnetic field, nor a particle, heat cannot be transferred. And only the other day, a few days back, they transferred heat between two plates with utter vacuum. They're revising the physics again. Physics, science, what is wrong in these approaches is they are not willing to look at the observer. Who is observing these things? And that bothered people a lot. That observer is creating the universe. Are we really creating the universe? Science says no, universe is there, we are observing it, and changes do take place. The quantum physics was created because somebody observed that the light photons, the particles of light that go, when they are unobserved, they go as waves. One photon can pass through two apertures in a plate and form a wave pattern on the screen. But if it is observed or measured, it becomes a particle. That we are converting energy into matter by our observation. That now it's acknowledged. They wanted to see how does an observation affect it? What is the power? Only a few months back, they conducted an experiment in which they said, supposing it is not a human observer, let's say a mechanical observer, electronic observer, they put a phenomenon in front of them, made two electronic observers, and a third human observer observing the two electronic observers. And they found the observer saw the electronic observer observing completely different things. And they came to the conclusion, in these words, there is no objective reality. They're big words. No objective reality, that we are creating our reality. Mystics have been saying this for thousands of years. Why do mystics say? They examine from where it comes. And can we verify what the mystics say? Yes. Through meditation that we are taught, it is possible to, by simply withdrawing our attention within ourselves, forgetting we have a body and that's what ourselves, looking at the inner bodies, going within two steps, you can find out the answer to all these questions. Why I'm mentioning these things to you is that the power of knowledge, of awareness that's available to us inside is so huge, so immense. They look like children playing outside who are working on this scientific experiment. They won't listen to us. Everything is empirical and outside. You have to prove by what is outside. Assume that to be real, then only science will begin. And they are now getting confused with these observations outside. In a way, I feel they will have to give up and say, let us look at the spiritual people, how do they describe? And I tell you, I predict this will happen. Science will give up its hands and say, yes, now let's look at what they have been saying for thousands of years, which is a better explanation than we can give. It's going to happen. I'm sharing these things with you because these are fascinating things that are happening around us at this time. Sometimes I feel we are very lucky to be born at this time. What if you were born long ago, wielding clubs and hitting each other in the Stone Age? I can't imagine doing that. I would be a failure in handling a big club to hit anybody. Or to say in the future, when we find the Earth, the planet Earth, has lost all its beauty, we are living in satellites outside, going around the planet, and the dead bodies from the satellites are being thrown as a garbage, then we made the planet which we loved so much into a grave. I don't want to live in that age. We are living in the best of times. Let's enjoy. Not only today's holiday, enjoy your life as the best holiday, because it's the best time to live here and best time to enjoy. Thank you very much. Happy New Year. Happy holidays. I'll see you in the new year now.